We're going to do a brief introduction to logic, so let's talk about some definitions. First, a statement is a sentence that can be judged as true or false. We have simple statements and compound statements. A simple statement conveys a single idea. Here are a few examples of simple statements. The arch is in Kansas City. Some people like fish, and all lakes have fresh water. Each one of these simple statements has a single idea that can be deemed to be true or false. The arch is not in Kansas City, it's in St. Louis, so that statement is false. Some people like fish, yes, I know some people who like fish, so that's a true statement. And all lakes have fresh water is not a true statement, there are some saltwater lakes. Okay, next, the negation of a statement has the opposite meaning of the statement. The negation of a true statement is false, and the negation of a false statement
is true.
So let's take these three statements above. We'll make a little bit of room here. Let's write the negation of each one of these statements. So in finding the negation of a statement, you're just coming up with what you would say if you're taking the other side of an argument. So, for example, if somebody told you that the arch is in Kansas City and you wanted to disagree, you would say, no, the arch is not in Kansas City. If somebody told you some people like fish and you wanted to take the other side of the argument, you would say, I disagree, no people like fish. And if somebody came to you and said that all lakes have fresh water and you wanted to disagree, you would say, no, that's not true because some lakes don't have fresh water. So let's make some rules. If a statement has the words, some are, then the negation of that statement is going to have the words, none are. The example of that is up here. Some people like fish, no people like fish. Next, if the statement has the words, none are, the negation of that statement will have the words, some are. If the original statement was, no people like fish, that would be a none are statement, and the negation of that would be some people like fish, some are. Okay, next rule, if a statement has the words all are, like all lakes have fresh water, then the negation of that statement is going to have the words some are not. And we can reverse that and say that if our original statement has the words some are not, then our negation will have the words all are. You can see that these two statements are grouped together, and these two statements are grouped together. So we can summarize all of these rules about statements and negations with these two things right here. Okay, moving on. The next thing that we want to define is a compound statement. And a compound statement combines two or more ideas. For example, Bill is a goat and Bill likes to play is two simple statements combined. We can determine whether the statement Bill is a goat is true or false, and we can determine whether the statement Bill likes to play is true or false. There's this and connecting these two statements that we're going to have to talk about in a minute. Next example, dinner comes with soup or salad and a side dish. There are actually three simple statements here. Dinner comes with soup, dinner comes with salad, dinner comes with a side dish. We can determine whether or not each of these three statements is true, and these three statements are connected with an or here and an and here. So I guess now is the time to say that simple statements are often combined together using connectives. We have a few common connectives, and we saw above, or we saw connecting simple statements above. We have if-then statements that we're going to talk about, and we have if and only if statements. We're going to talk about all of these connectives soon enough. Let's start by talking about some symbols that we use for logic. Remember those negations that we talked about a second ago? Well, we use a little squiggly tilde symbol to denote negations, and when we're reading this negation symbol in a statement later, we're going to read it as the word not. We're going to use this symbol here to represent and this is called a conjunction. One more for now. We're going to use this symbol here to represent or, and we call that a disjunction. So let's look at some examples of how we use these symbols. We're going to let P represent the statement dinner includes soup, Q is going to represent dinner includes salad, and R is going to represent dinner includes a side dish. So what if we wanted to symbolize dinner does not include soup? Well, that statement is the negation of statement P. So we would symbolize this with negation P or not P. What if we wanted to say dinner includes salad and a side dish? Well, you can see that these two statements are combined with the connective and. Dinner includes salad is represented by Q, and we're going to write like this. And dinner includes a side dish is represented by R. Now these can get more complicated. What if we want to say dinner does not include soup or dinner includes salad? That compound statement would be represented by not P, that means dinner does not include soup, or we're going to use this symbol for, and dinner includes salad is represented by Q. So in symbolic form, this long statement would be not P or Q. Let's do a couple more examples because these can get a little bit confusing. Let's break down the statement, dinner comes with soup or salad and a side dish. Now, as I've written this, this statement is actually pretty ambiguous because we don't know whether to group together the soup or salad or whether we should group together the salad and a side dish. So we need a comma in this compound statement to tell us. If I put a comma right here, then what the sentence says is first, dinner comes with soup, and that's it. That's the end of one statement. That statement is represented by a P. Then the next statement is, dinner comes with salad and a side dish. Dinner comes with salad and dinner comes with a side dish would be represented by Q and R. And because the comma is here, we're grouping together those two simple statements. And in between this simple statement and this simple statement, we have an or. So with this statement, we say you have a choice. You can either take the soup, or your other option is you can get salad and a side dish. But what if we had put this comma somewhere else? What if we had put our comma here? Now the first piece of this statement says that dinner comes with soup or salad. We would write that as P or Q, and that would be grouped together. The other statement says that dinner comes with a side dish. That statement is R, and connecting these two pieces is an and, so that would look like this. So now this statement, just with the comma moved, says that dinner is either going to come with soup or salad. You get to choose, and then your dinner also comes with a side dish. In short, the placement of this comma is very important. So look for those commas so that you know where to put your parentheses. All right, let's take a look at another example. Let's say P represents the statement, the car is fast. Q represents the simple statement, the tires are small. Here we have some conjunctions in symbolic form. Let's write out the sentences that those represent. This first compound statement starts with not P. Now, not P would mean the car is not fast. Then we have an and Q is the statement the tires are small. So there it is. This symbolic statement here means the car is not fast and the tires are small. This second statement looks very similar, except there are parentheses. So this negation negates this entire statement here, not just the P. So when this is the case, we usually start our statements with, it is not true that. That piece is what is meant by this negation out here, and now we can write down the statement inside these parentheses. The statement inside the parentheses is, the car is fast, we have an and the tires are small. Okay, so hopefully that example helps you out a little bit with parentheses in these logical statements. Now we've talked about symbols for the connectives and an or, but we have a couple more to talk about. This if-then connective is symbolized by this arrow here, and we call it a conditional. As an example, we could represent you get an excellent rating by the letter P, and you get a raise by the letter Q. If this is the case, P then Q represents the statement. If you get an excellent rating, then you get a raise. There's one more connective. It's called the biconditional. It's symbolized by this double arrow here, and it's read if and only if. If we write Q and then the biconditional P, that is the same thing as if we write P and then the biconditional Q. And either way, this says you get a raise if and only if you get an excellent rating. And there's a subtle difference between these two statements. The first statement up here says that if you get an excellent rating, then you get a raise. But it leaves open the possibility that you could do something else to get a raise. However, this statement down here says you will get a raise if and only if you get an excellent rating, meaning the only way you can get a raise is if you get an excellent rating. And if you get an excellent rating, you will get a raise. So, okay, I hope that introduction to symbols and logic and statements helps you out. Hopefully it'll get you started on the homework. I'll see you next time.